Next weekend, the North Shore branch of the New Zealand Amateur Radio Transmitter Society will do another block course. It's one of those pressure cooker thingies running over Saturday and Sunday. And I will be talking about receivers and transmitters, amongst other things. So I thought I'd do an introduction of what receivers look like for amateur radio use in the related uses, and also show you quickly what I can use them for. The gear that I still use is ancient by today's standards. It was bought in the last century. Here is a TS570S, which is a transmitter receiver for short waves as well as medium waves on receive. At the moment, it is receiving a weather fax, and here we have just the start of a New Zealand Met Office weather fax transmission. I'll come back to it later on when it's advanced a bit more. So the Kenwood TS570S is a receiver transmitter. It has a receiver built in as well as a transmitter, and you change over by using push to talk on the microphone on top, but it's also got buttons for it. The layout has remained in today's transmitter receivers comparable to this one, but there are of course a couple of advantages available now that this one hasn't got yet. Another ancient design is a portable receiver that I also bought last century, and it's still going and still in use. But again, new receivers that are about paperback sized are still being produced, in spite of the fact that a lot of broadcasting has gone over to the internet and to satellites. You can see that it's tuned to a weather fax frequency, the one that I just used 15 minutes ago. While my transceiver is receiving another fax transmission, I've taken my portable receiver outside to get away from the computer noise. This particular frequency on the 40 meter amateur radio band is used for data. Of course, now that I've found a spot where the sun will actually illuminate the display, they stopped transmitting. So here is a completed fax transmission from the New Zealand Met Service. Here is another New Zealand Met Service weather fax reception in progress. The small rectangle on the right side is a spectrum display, and the spike at the right represents the white tones. Because the blacks are only blips, they hardly show up in the spectrum display. A related data form to fax is SOSCAN television. It's the same principle, but they have worked out how to receive in color. Although you hear a lot of noise, you actually do see a picture developing, because this program called MMSS TV has got a very good audio filter built into the software. I wasn't really expecting any reception on slow scan TV at this time of the day. At the bottom, you see various pictures that I have taken ready for transmission. Going back through the history, here is a response from a Japanese station. to my transmission in the bottom left corner. It's what he received from me. It's not very distinct. I transmitted it. It was already a bit noisy. When he comes back, it was not noisy, still a bit. That is a better response to one of my pictures. And now we are receiving another picture. I can make it larger. If I go to the history, I may be able to make it a little bit less noisy. So I go to the history, and at the bottom I have a denoiser. I would have to look up where that station is coming from. The bottom one looks like a United States station. I am now finding the cursor and going to transmit. The line coming down the picture indicates that I am transmitting and how much of my picture has been transmitted. And here is my trusty pocket receiver that is allowing me to monitor what I am sending out. If I don't have a strong enough tone, then I actually transmit computer interference only. I have to make sure that my modulation is strong enough to actually send a picture and not a load of garbage. This is an amplitude modulated form of data transmission. You're actually sending out an analog tone, which is then converted to levels in red, green, and blue. It is unlikely that I am getting a response at this time of the day. There is a signal that's just audible, but it is not actually triggering the receive function of my program. An aspect that I will not talk about this time is the station layout. But I might show you how my shack works anyway. My aerial comes in with a great wire and it goes up to the antenna tuner unit, and from there, from the antenna tuner unit, it goes to a switch. And the reason for that one is I have two transmitters with various inputs and outputs, so I can choose. But instead of going on HF directly to the transmitter, I am going through an elliptical filter that I constructed myself for historical reasons. We used to have television in a band going from low VHF to high VHF, something like 40 to 180 megahertz, and it was quite easy to cause interference in that band to television transmissions. So this elliptical filter is tuned to the old TV1 and TV2 frequencies, and I'll take it down in a minute and show you the inside. Anyway, from the filter we go to the transmitter. I found that I had a faulty cable, so this is actually a cable that is really intended for UHF use, but it hasn't got any faults in it. Home constructed, of course, and you do make mistakes. And then we go to the transmitter. So that's basically my station layout. I can also use this transmitter for HF as well as VHF. This transmitter is simpler in as much as it only covers short waves, and for reception medium wave as well. This one is a satellite transmitter, which is no longer quite up to date, but it's still quite useful because it does cover VHF, UHF and HF. So here is my elliptical filter built last century. Two parallel tuned circuit in series with capacitors going to ground as well. The PC boards actually are the capacitors. They're probably good for 2 kilowatts or something like that. The calculations for the correct size of these capacitors came from the American Radio Relay League handbook. I forget now which year, I have to dig it up again. And so did the coils. The idea of the elliptical filter is that it has an input and an output impedance of 50 ohm. If you are mismatched for any reason, then the elliptical filter will not do its job. Therefore, the transmitter has to be tuned to 50 ohms, and the antenna has to be tuned to 50 ohms. And that explains why I have the antenna tuner coming after the elliptical filter. In order to keep the two parallel tuned circuits totally separate, I have actually put a screen into the lid as well. And this is how the filter goes back together again. Notice the double screen. Now, why would I use a filter designed against interference for TV stations of a bygone age? The reason is that the filter, although specifically for two spot frequencies, also attenuates over a wide band. Therefore, it reduces interference to domestic equipment that may not have any appreciable resistance to strong signals anywhere in the house. So with the filter in, I am reducing interference to sound as entertainment equipment.